Shin or ball for your roundhouse kicks? What is the difference? And when should you use each? Let's experiment to find out, starting with the key scientific differences.
To compare any two techniques, I use my three-factor classification matrix.
First, kinetic energy. This captures both speed and effective mass, and is measured by the PowerKube. Second, contact area. This determines pressure and force distribution, and you can estimate by measuring your weapon. Third, impact duration. This controls damage type and power. Simply divide your kinetic energy by the power figures on the power cube. The beauty of this matrix is that with a power cube, you can classify any technique using just these three measurements.
Use my code WarriorCodex for 10% off with PowerKube and to help support the channel. Now using these three factors, I'm going to break down and compare the differences between the shin and the ball of the foot roundhouse kick.
Starting with kinetic energy, the shin generated 212 joules and the ball generated 105 joules. That's 67% more energy from the shin. When compared to the kinetic energy matrix, the shin classifies as heavy and the ball as light.
Let's dig a little deeper to find out why. Kinetic energy comes from two factors, mass and velocity.
Using motion capture to measure velocity, we can see the shin reaches 9.43 meters per second at impact, while the ball reaches 7.98 meters per second.
This velocity difference reflects Newton's third law, equal and opposite reaction.
The force delivered returns to your weapon. The shin's thick bone structure can handle high forces, while the ball of the foot and ankle's intricate bone structure restrict the force you can safely apply. Speed reduction is one way you can control this force output.
With conditioning, speed increases, but these structural limitations still remain. Next, we can calculate effective mass at impact using these velocity numbers.
And we find the shin delivers 1.5 kilograms more effective mass to the target. The shin's extra effective mass comes from using the entire leg structure, not just the foot.
Which takes us to our next factor, contact area.
The shin covers 217 square centimeters of impact surface, and the ball of the foot has about one third at just 72 square centimeters. When compared to the contact area matrix, the shin classifies as broad and the ball as compact.
The way I measure these is using the hand for scale. Quarter, such as a palm heel, is a pinpoint weapon. Half, such as a fist, is a compact weapon, and the whole hand, such as a slap, is a broad weapon. To further expand the contact area measurements, we can calculate pressure. A smaller contact area creates higher pressure, even with less force.
Using my calculator, which I detailed in the front kick video, I calculated force against a stationary opponent of the same weight as me. The shin generates over 12,000 newtons, while the ball is around 5,500.
Despite the ball of the foot generating 76% less force, it actually generates 30% more pressure. To put this in perspective, standard tire pressures are 220 kilopascals. The ball of the foot generates three times that, and the shin 2.5 times. But there's a critical difference. Tire pressure is consistent, whereas the shin and the ball of the foot generate their pressure almost instantly. Which brings us to our next factor, impact duration.
The shin's damage dealing phase lasts 4.8 milliseconds. The ball of the foot's damage phase lasts 6.4 milliseconds. These are incredibly short timeframes. A human eye blink takes on average 150 milliseconds. So both impacts happen in less than 5% of a blink. Now, for clarification, total contact time, including deceleration, is much longer, around 25 milliseconds. But the damage occurs in that initial impact phase.
Impact duration is calculated with the relationship between power and energy measured from the power cube. Impact duration equals energy divided by power.
When compared to the impact duration matrix, both techniques classify as striking, which is under 15 milliseconds.
Confirming they are both optimized for rapid energy delivery, not sustained pressure. Now let's recap all three factors and the fundamental differences so we can understand when to use each technique.
Our analysis reveals the shin is a heavy weapon with a broad contact area optimized for striking. The ball of the foot is a light weapon with a compact surface area, also optimized for striking. The fundamental difference, the shin delivers maximum energy transfer, the ball of the foot creates maximum pressure concentration.
This means that each technique excels in completely different tactical situations. The first situation to consider is the target.
When assessing targets, we need to determine two factors: tissue type and conditioning level. Tissue will either be hard, such as bone, or soft, such as muscles, tendons, ligaments, and organs. And an area will be conditioned, such as the quads, iliotibial band, and the forearms, or unconditioned, such as the inner thigh, the diaphragm, or the liver.
If an area is hard or conditioned, we want to avoid using weapons that are easily damaged. In this case, the ball of the foot. Remember Newton's third law? The force we deliver returns to our weapon. These hard and conditioned areas are best attacked with broad conditioned weapons, such as the shin, which can easily absorb the returned force. My general targets when it comes to using the ball of the foot are the adductor muscles on the inside of the thigh, the diaphragm just below the rib cage, and the liver off to the right-hand side. Now we've got three targets, and we need to start thinking about our opponent's defense, which is our second tactical consideration. The first target we'll look at is the inside of the thigh. With all of my ball of the foot kicks, I will lift my knee up in the same motion. This can lead to a leg check, can lead to a front kick, could lead to an inside thigh kick, it could lead to a roundhouse kick. This is the idea, is that we have one movement that has multiple options, keeps our opponent guessing. So in terms of our inside thigh, we bring it up, we extend the knee, point the toes, rotate the hip. This leg doesn't need to move. Up, rotate, ball of the foot, and it can become a very quick little snap just to the inside of the thigh. Our second option would be hitting the opponent's back leg. Depending on distance, we might be able to just bring this back leg straight through and hit that ball to the inside of their opponent's thigh. Bringing it up, digging it in. Taking the back leg, digging it straight into the inside of the thigh, inside of the thigh. Now some styles actually use the big toe, meaning that pressure point becomes even smaller. My toes are not conditioned for that though. That's something that you've got to build up to. Our second target we're gonna look at is gonna be the diaphragm. Now, typically the diaphragm, being a frontal target, is gonna be hard to hit with our roundhouse kick. So instead, I'm gonna use the same ball of the foot, but I'm gonna use my front kick as the setup to then hit the liver, our third target, with the roundhouse kick. So again, lift that knee, that same motion here, and then I can snap out with that snapping, teeping motion, that front kick to the diaphragm. What we'll typically see is the opponent will have a gap in their guard so we can get this kick right up the middle. As we start to land it, they're likely to start moving the elbows to the center line to block it with the forearm, either elbow, or maybe both elbows. When that occurs, my guard's here, center's open. If I move my elbow to the center here, the liver or the ribs around here become exposed. So that same motion where I come up and out, I come up, I rotate the leg out, ball of the foot, and I come around with a roundhouse kick. Same thing, up, up, and around now. You can pivot slightly with the back foot, but you can actually land it from that lead without needing to pivot too much on the back foot. So that's how we can get access to the liver. So I'm up, hit the middle, and then as the guard comes to the center, come up, around, and hit with the ball of the foot to the outside. Hop, and then the outside. Now, if you wanted to hit the diaphragm with the roundhouse kick with the ball of the foot, we can think about having the guard in the middle here. Again, if we throw the shin is gonna land across both the arms. But if we go from an extended position, such as this, to a ball of the foot, such as that, we can actually come through the middle between the two arms. So what I can think about doing, stepping off, roundhouse kick, it's gonna hit flat. But if I come off, hit with the ball of the foot, I may be able to cut the middle of the guard. That same idea also applies to throwing the roundhouse kick to the outside. If they're blocking here, got that Dutch guard, Dutch block, roundhouse kick with a straight leg, as we can see again here, Stand the toes, ball the foot. We can actually still land a shot if the shin's here, the ball of foot will hit the lats or even the ribs behind the guard. This is just one example of how applying scientific insights and biomechanics can dramatically improve your martial arts performance, allowing you to choose the right technique for each situation. Technology such as the PowerKube and motion capture allow us to see these hidden insights, which traditional training often misses. Let me know in the comments which martial arts techniques or concepts you would like to see tested. I read all the comments and I use them to plan future videos. If this video helped you understand the science behind your martial arts, make sure to give it a like and subscribe so you don't miss the next breakdown. And remember to share this with your fellow martial artists.